Classes in Wargame Design, a series of lectures based on George Philly's book, Designing Board Wargames Introduction, to be available from Smashwords.com and Amazon Kindle. And today, Lecture 2, Characteristics of Board Wargames.
I'm Professor Phillies, and this is why crews have blooper reels. I'm Professor Phillies, and this is Lecture 2 of Designing Board Wargames. Where are we? Well, last time we discussed general variables that occupy all games. We talked about representations. What you see if you look at the table. We talked about theme. Theme is what the game is about if you aren't quite sure what to say about it. We talked about mechanisms and styles. The mechanisms are the little pieces that you assemble together in the rules, and when you assemble enough mechanisms, if you do a good job of it, you actually have a game. We talked about shape. Shape is how much of the player's life the game occupies. And at the bottom end you have scissors, paper, rocks. And at the top end you have board war games, a game like Campaign for North Africa, effectively played by about 10 players with several hundred hours of playing time. We talked about components. Whatever falls out of the box when you turn it upside down. We talked a bit about voice. Voice, of course, is familiar to everyone who describes a computer game as a first-person shooter. It is first-person, and you see things. But under modern conditions, literary fiction is written first-person present tense, but romantic fiction, science fiction, detective novels, even romance novels, are usually written in third-person past tense. So we have this list, and I will add to that one more. Content. Content is the information you put into the game, novel or whatever, so you can see what it is. Content may be very shallow or very deep. If we talk about the board game Puerto Rico, you have little boxes and barrels that represent goods being shipped. You have little counters that represent colonists that make things work. The game sort of skips over the issue that on sugar plantations, those were not colonists, that was all slave labor. On the other hand, if you advance to a large board war game, you will have hundreds or thousands of unit counters, little paper squares. You will have a healthily large map. And from all of this, well, the content is what tells you what you put on those pieces. That is, in Puerto Rico, it's sugar and indigo and spices and whatnot. On the other hand, if you're doing World War II, it's all of the unit identifications and how strong they were and how fast they could move. It's the information you use to give the game reality. So that approximately were the seven things we talked about last time. Board war games, the sort of board war games we're talking about, are characterized by theme, namely warfare. They're characterized by components, that is, map, counters, and the map is something that has a grid on it, more or less typically. And the content issue is the historical, perhaps, content. So that's what we talked about last time. Now let's push ahead. And let us consider where we want to go next. Well, there's one point I want to expand on from last time because it's extremely important. And that is the distinction between the plot hook. It has pirates and vampires and zombies in it. And the plot is what actually happens. Now, plot in novels and plot in games has two sorts of different roles. Novels, one can imagine a plot outline which tells you chapter by chapter what is going to take place. In the classic Tom Swift senior novels, the Stratemeyer Syndicate had a formula. In chapter 2, Tom Swift would always meet the villain. And the villain would perpetrate some piece of villainy. And because it never occurred to Tom Swift that he should carry with him his electronic death ray projector, which by World War I standards was extremely impressive, it's actually better than George Pal's Martian's death ray, he never got rid of the villain in chapter 2, and therefore in chapters 3 through 26, odd and unfortunate things had to happen. So that's sort of plot. It's an outline. In a game, the thing that corresponds to the plot could be described as the rules, which tell the game what to do, and the components, which are the things you do them with. Now, the amount of freedom you have, given that you have rules and components, can vary a great deal. Nonetheless, you have rules and components and things you can do them with. I will now use a role gaming illustration of freedom. And at one end of freedom, you have a set of rules that basically give you the laws of nature or unnatural behavior. A good example of this is the first edition plywood box Dungeons and Dragons, which is a list of spells, components hadn't been invented, a list of weapons, but not very much detail, they all did damage, and some general comments on things you might encounter, and a few comments on designing dungeons, but basically everything else came out of the creativity of the Games Master. However, having said we have laws of nature, we now have two branches. And one branch I will call the encounter. And the notion of encounter is that you are a games master, and yes, you're creative, but you actually need to invent the contents of 38 rooms or 12 village huts by next Saturday. So you look this up, and in room 1, there are 3 silver pieces. And in room 2, there are 52 extremely angry whites. And we go down the list, and someone will give you a detailed description of a few rooms, or you meet some people at a tavern and something happens, and it's a short one-page event. That's an encounter. The alternative is to say, we won't just tell you the laws of nature, we'll describe, not in ultimately fine detail, the world you find yourself in. And the world description is, here are the background politics, here are places you can be with geography and so forth. And the first couple of these were assuredly would include White Bear, Red Moon, which was Greg Stafford's effort. And then there was Empire of the Pebble Throne, which was very detailed in its description, and Empire of the Pebble Throne was the creation of Mohammed Abdul Rahman Barker, who was a Minneapolis fellow who also did some novels in it. And these were detailed descriptions of politics, religion, and so forth, so that you knew the world you were going into. I am deliberately going down the board because at the bottom, we eventually hit the module. And I suppose we should say we hit two modules, free and scripted. And in the free module, you have a very extensive description of a moderate town and what is going on in the town and some things that the players don't know about immediately. But the players walk through just as if you had arrived by boat on an unknown coast, and you could walk through the town and things would happen. There were also the scripted modules. The scripted modules would say, first the players do X, and then no matter what the players do, they will meet the following person. And no matter what the players do, they will be shoved along by the games master, and they will go out to the house at the outskirts of town and have an unpleasant event. And the players were marched through. And the scripted modules had this object known as script immunity. And the notion of script immunity was that no matter what the players did, nothing would happen. You were trapped on Gilligan's Island, famous TV show of a long time ago. No matter what you do, at the end of the show, you will still be on Gilligan's Island. Well, that's TV, and if you say the episodes can be shown in any order, you're sort of stuck with that. However, the notion of the scripted module is the games master did not have to think at all, or at least not very much. He just sort of ran through things. The disadvantage of the scripted module, it's like a computer game. You play it, and now you know all the solutions, and you can plow through it. The other disadvantage, of course, is that whoever designed it may not have been very thoughtful. There was one unfortunate case described to me some years back. And so here is the invincible stronghold of frost giants or some fool thing. And there's one entrance. And the player characters have attacked it several times and been wiped out every time without getting to the front door. And someone who knew something about tactics showed up, not me, and did tactical things. And for the duration of the event, the games master said, "You're cheating. You're cheating. You can't do that." But of course they could. And at the end, not only had they won, but they'd taken no losses in the process. The attitude of people who started role-playing up here towards these things was that people who used these things had found their objective in life. Their objective in life was to prove that Darwin's theory of evolution was exactly backwards. However, we have rules and we have components. We don't have script immunity in board war games, but we do have idiocy rules, which we will get to by and by. And idiocy rules do approximately the same thing. I am pounding on this distinction between plots and plot hooks, because if you're actually designing, those of you who haven't designed a bunch of things, saying that you're going to design and what asking where are we in the process can be a little obscure. Last point before we get off, general topic of game design. There's a lot more in the book, which I don't have time to read out loud, of course. And the last point I want to point out is top-down versus bottom up as a design approach. And the notion of top down is could be as simple as we have a bubble. And now we break it into bubbles, each of which is as large as the original. And now we break each of the bubbles into more bubbles, each of which is as large as the original. And we eventually fill in what's inside the bubbles. And if we're careful, we get a game out. The bottom-up approach is to have some general idea of where you're going. And then we are doing a mosaic, and we do one beautiful tessera at a time. And when we are done making all of the mosaic tiles, we may have to shovel things around again a bit. But at the end, we have a beautiful mosaic. Now, in novel writing, there are two approaches here. And one approach is the person who outlines everything in as much detail as possible. Jim Bain, who was editor at Bain Books, advocated this. And only when you were done outlining did you start writing. The other choice is to say, well, I know roughly what the world is, and I know vaguely where we want to go, and we will construct one scene at a time. And the scenes will be very well constructed, and they may have to be shuffled a bit, or you may have to chop some of them out, but at the end you will be done. The reason I am bringing up the top-down and bottom-up approach is that there are a certain number of people in the world who are top-down people. There are a certain number of people who are bottom-up people. Mixed in here someplace is progressive refinement. And people who see things in these different ways don't often fit together too well because they don't see things. There was an occasion, I've written several novels, on which I endeavored to integrate with another fellow whose novel writing publishing level is about the same as mine and whose writing skill is good. And we discovered he wanted a plot outline. And my idea of developing a character is, here's about 10 pages of event, and it certainly shows you the character and background. And we didn't interact, so that didn't turn out. It's just an issue. Okay, I have now warned you about plot hooks and versus plot, and I view this as very important because otherwise you can sit there and you can do vast amounts of historical research, and you've piled up all sorts of information on, say, the Battle of Bennington and the name of every man who fought and woman who fought in the battle. And at some point, someone will be mean and ask you, where is the game? Where is this all going? And if you don't remember there has to be a plot, you can get lost this way. Okay. So let us advance to Chapter 3. And Chapter 3 discusses features that are particularly characteristic of board war games. And there are a set of variables that generally characterize and describe board war games, and the variables are not the same as these general variables like theme and shape and so forth. Once we say we have a board war game, what is traditionally called a hex and counter board war game, most of those theme representation things are fixed. The mechanisms aren't fixed, but to a certain extent it's warfare. You probably need some rules on combat. You probably need some rules on getting whatever it is into locations where it can engage in combat. And then there are other topics that are traditional military interest. But let us actually talk about wargame variables. And we actually go back to the Avalon Hill General in about 1969 in an article by a gentleman by the name of Giberson. And what Giberson said was that there were three sorts of variables, three axes you could talk about. And one was called playability, which he emphasized was not quite the same as complexity. And I'll give some examples of that perhaps. And that was a variable. And then there was a variable he called play balance, and play balance was viewed as being, what are the chances that each side will win? And then there was a variable which I'll call historicity, which could be said to include realism. And it could be said to include accuracy. Those aren't quite the same thing. He said, here are these three variables, and we can put down any game on the axis. And in his opinion, the most important variables were these. It didn't matter that much if the game was playable or not, though he didn't want unplayable games. The play balance did not matter at all. His interest was very strictly what he viewed as historical accuracy. He did propose something that has since become much more common, namely that if you had a battle that was slightly unbalanced, oh, say, the German invasion of Luxembourg in 1940, Luxembourgese had no military, One thing you could do is to assign victory points to various objectives, and you totaled up the victory points, and depending on how well the player did, there was a win or a loss for one side or the other. So those are Giberson's ideas on variables. Now, Giberson's ideas on variables, the original article was much more sophisticated than what has usually been done with it since. Because what has usually been done with it since is to say, we will take these three or maybe four variables, which are independent axes, and we will say there is one axis. And one, at one end is there something that is called playable, and at the other end there is an end called realistic. And we've now taken very different variables and we've compressed them onto a straight line. And if you read the Perla book on simulating warfare, it's one of the books I mentioned in the introduction, he is very much interested in this line. And he is very much interested at this end. And the level of complexity he has is that you may have 50 or 100 players representing different naval issues, including a large team of umpires, large amounts of electronics. Serious war game. And at the other end, you could have something that's extremely simple-minded and playable. I suppose at the very bottom end, checkers qualifies as being eminently playable. The rules are simple. They're straightforward. It happens that the game has a solution. It's a draw. But there's an axis. And this notion that realism and playability are opposite to each other somewhat confuses many discussions you will have. Okay. So having started with the father of general discussion on wargame features, let us ask what features you can put into a wargame, qualitative types of feature in the same sense the theme is a type. Well, size, complexity, that's not the same as size. Okay, how about depth? Realism can take you dangerously astray. Accuracy, that's not quite the same as realism. Okay, then of course, there is what we might call game quality. And buried under here is the audience. The audience is the people to whom you are trying to sell the product. One thing you need to realize is that there are multiple audiences, just as there are multiple computer game audiences, and they do not all want the same thing. Of course, saying there is an audience and saying you can design a game that will appeal to that audience are different matters. Some of you will realize there are a long series of efforts, there are several people here who could talk about this in more detail than I can, to design computer games that will appeal to little girls, say, 5 to 10, or 7 to 12, something in there. These efforts have been inspired, there's been a lot of work behind them, but you can't exactly say they've worked perfectly well. But you have to, so the fact there is an audience doesn't mean you can write for it, but you ought to know there are audiences. So let's start at the top with size. At the bottom end, there are games that quite literally hit on a postcard. Well, you have to cut out the postcard because they're like 5 or 10 pieces, playing pieces. You have to supply a die yourself, obviously, because it fits on a postcard. The rules fit on the reverse side of the postcard, not in very large print, and it is a board war game. Indeed, if you read, which you should, Jim Dunnigan's book on board war games, he gives a board war game that is not much bigger than this. So let us march through. We're going to talk about Stalingrad as an exemplary board game. I'm not saying good or bad, I'm just saying it's a wonderful introductory example. And that has about 100 pieces. And we will talk about 1914, which is not as much larger as it looks, but it has a couple hundred. And we will eventually talk about Panzerblitz. And when we talk about Panzerblitz and its descendants, well, you can do scenarios of very different sizes, so the game gets bigger. And eventually we get to games like, oh, Fire in the East. Fire in the East is the same game topic as Stalingrad. However, Fire in the East comes in a big, heavy box that is almost totally stuffed with sheets of unit counters. It has hundreds and hundreds, maybe I should say thousands of unit counters. And eventually we get up to Campaign for North Africa. And we eventually get up to, it's about the same size, the MIT SGS game, Tactics Pi, which is very large but very simple. It's designed for hooking in people who have never played a board war game, and they get to play something that is large enough that even if they make some mistakes, nothing terribly awful happens. So, that's a piece, that's size. What about map size? Well, there's a practical design issue. If I am standing at a table and bending forward, even when I was much younger and did not have issues with depth of field focus on my vision, you can sort of reach in about two or three feet, but not more. That means that your game table can't really be more than about 5 feet wide because people can't get at the middle. It can, however, be as long as you want, and Tactics Pi was about 20 feet. Lots of space for lots of people to play. So, that's size. What about complexity? There are various ways you can get complexity. There are different sorts of complexity. One is to say we will make the rules longer or shorter. Now, it's worthwhile to emphasize, we're talking about board war games, not computer games. In computer games, you can hide the rules. In fact, it can be completely impossible for the players to figure out what the rules are or why nothing seems to work the way you think it should because the designer had some interesting ideas. But in a board war game, all the rules have to be written down so the players can execute them. A board war game is run not by an AI, an artificial intelligence, but by an NI, a natural intelligence, using built-in wetware. So having said that, at the short end, you can get by with a few sheets of paper and fine print, sort of textbook size, two column, and you have a fairly detailed board war game. And here's an example. At the other end of complexity, it is impossible to avoid mentioning Advanced Squad Leader. Advanced Squad Leader had a 140-page rule book, not counting, that was the basic rule book, not counting the supplements. The rule book came in a ring binder, a fairly heavy paper, so you could open it and it would lay flat no matter what page you were on. For example, the full page discussing how you move infantry through sanitary sewers. An important rule. They had plenty of other rules. They also had all of the additions, all of the additional unit counters, a complete game including the variant modules. Well, I suppose D&D players would say small, might be this thick. I will not bring my set in of all of the pieces, but it's quite imposing. And then there are all of the extra maps, some dozens of them. So, very complicated game, covers all sorts of aspects. There are, however, other ways to make a game complex. For example, if you think of chess, you move a piece, you either do or do not capture. Your opponent does the same. On rare occasions, if it's a pawn, you choose what piece you're going to promote to. But it's basically a move attack, and that's it. You can do much more complicated things with the rules, where all sorts of different things happen, either in a fixed sequence or in a floating sequence. We'll look at some of both of those. And now things get more complicated. You could also say, we will go for the pursuit of limited intelligence, namely each side does not know what the other side is doing, and therefore pieces must be hidden from each other. This is very difficult to do in a paper game. There are some ways of doing it. However, the net result is you can get rules that are much more complicated. So that's complexity. Now we come to depth. Depth is something you might want to design for or have. That's actually very difficult to do, because in order to have a lot of depth, to a certain extent, you have to have game balance, and game balance that maintains itself as players get better and better. If you don't, the depth will never be developed. So of the classic games, well, let's see, there's chess. And chess has Elo rankings. And at the bottom end, in some federations, you can get negative chess rankings. In other, you bottom at zero, so the kids who are 7 years old and playing do not become too demoralized. A rating near zero sort of indicates you've known most of the rules, maybe not en passant capture. And now we push out, and at some place around 2900, you have the Anons and the Judith Polgars and the other really good players. And a general statement is that if you're separated by something like 400 points, this is imprecise. Elo is not a skill ranking in the usual sense. The lower ranked player will lose more or less every time. And so you could say, in a certain sense, there are at least 8 or maybe 9, because it's a little fuzzy at one end, levels of depth. On the other hand, if you have the Japanese game of Go, you have some dozens of amateur rankings, and you have another round number, dozen professional rankings. That's a little more than that. And the rankings are such that if the skill levels of the players are well known, the lower level player will consistently lose unless they're given a handicap. And Go, as a result of however it was created, eventually, you can actually give accurate handicaps. The player starts with a certain number of stones on the board at the start of the game. And as a result, the game of Go has maybe 3 dozen play levels. At the top end, the levels get compressed a bit. The game has around 3 dozen play levels. That's about as deep as you can get. However, instead of saying we'll design for depth, you could say I'll design for shallowness. And someone who did this quite deliberately was Brett Morell. The game is called Duel of Ages. And the game was designed, there is a certain amount of luck in it, and the design objective was that an extremely good player playing an extremely weak player, the win-loss ratio would be about 80-20, but not more. So that both players would have some interest in it, even if one of them was much better than the other. So that is depth and shallowness. Mixed in with depth and shallowness is play balance. That was one of Giberson's ideas. And the issue in play balance is that if you're going to play a game, both sides should have something like an even chance of winning. And so if the game is balanced and we're equally good, and I play one side and you play side B, and I'm playing side A, we play 50 games, we've each won around 25. And if we switch sides, it may still be true. If we play 50 games, each of us have won 25. That's roughly what balance is. Balance is something that gives you quality of game under some conditions. Now we come to realism. and accuracy. And there's a design choice here. And the design choice is called design for, and one of the design choices is effect, and the other design choice is realism, or accuracy, I should say accuracy. The notion of design for accuracy is that we have a large number of variables we have to represent. And if we represent them all completely well, the game will resemble what happened in the real world. So we have all of these weapons which have different ranges and likelihoods of hitting the target and likelihoods of damaging the target if they hit it. And if we put in all of the factors well enough, we should have a game that will play well. This is not as easy as it sounds. It is most practical with contemporary back to World War II, where you at least have tons and tons of information. As you go further and further back, the quality of your information goes downhill. For example, there was the English general Marlborough, Churchill was one of his descendants, who fought at the Battle of Blenheim, which was decisive battle of the period. Of all of the private soldiers in his army, whose number we do not know that accurately, we can name about seven of them. And the rest, all that information is gone. The company commanders or sergeants or captains may have known who their men were, but they didn't take lists by name, they just counted, and therefore matters, we just can't duplicate things. The alternative to design for accuracy, this is something that Jim Dunnigan pushed very much in Panzerblitz, which is one of the games we're going to go through in detail, was design for effect. That is, the details aren't right, but if you play it, it looks just like reality is seen from a distance. Now, Panzerblitz is a platoon-level game, so you have a group of about 50, mostly men. I have to say mostly. The Russians used women most, not that much in front line, in combat a great deal. Very much at the end of World War II, the Germans took the women's equivalent of the Hitler Youth, and a significant number of them actually got into combat. Not a large number, but enough that it happened. We didn't do it that way. However, in any event, the notion is there's this 150 guys pushing ahead, and someone is shooting at them with a mortar. Now, you could say, we will calculate what is the likelihood of hitting person A or B or C, and what is the likelihood of this wound and that wound, and what would these people do as a result of doctrine. Doctrine is very important. We'll get to it later in the course. But what Jim said is the general issue is as follows. You're shooting at this group of people. They're trained soldiers. It may be someone is wounded or killed. In which case, if they're wounded, you leave a couple people back to take care of them, but the unit advances. But every so often, you manage to score a hit and knock off the officer or one of the senior sergeants, and now you actually have to do reorganization. Or you get lucky and you have a dozen people down, and suddenly the unit, everyone is dead, it's they come to a stop, and they have to reorganize, and they have to get things back in order. And over the length of the game, which is only 30 or 60 minutes, as Panzerblitz simulates, represents what might happen on the battlefield in a half hour or an hour, in that half hour period, they aren't going to do anything else because they've got to get their act back together. And this unit, from the standpoint of the Panzerblitz rules, it's been dispersed a couple times, that is, been hit, there's been some damage, is removed from the board. The people in the unit are mostly not dead. It's just the unit has been inactive. Now, you might, as an alternative rule, say the unit is not dead, but it's been inactivated, and therefore, even though it doesn't move and it won't attack anyone, if you try to march enemy troops through it, they will shoot at the enemy troops out of self-preservation. But the design for effect is that you score a few hits and perhaps only a small number of people die, and the unit is removed from the board. The limitation on design for effect, and this comes back to the size issue I mentioned, is that if you take a design for effect rule and start moving outside of its area of validity, you get into trouble. Panzerblitz has another design for effect. Suppose I am marching through Vietnam, I barely avoided this, with an M16 and 700 rounds of ammunition. This gets heavy, but people could carry that much. And we get into a firefight. If I actually started loading magazines as fast as I could and blasting away at full automatic, I could get through all of my ammunition in 5 or 10 minutes, allowing I had some didn't have a speed reloader. Well, individual engagements were very short. And therefore, over the course of an engagement, it would be uncommon for people to run out of ammunition. Though, when the Army redesigned the M16, they eliminated the full auto-fire version because people managed to do this. And therefore, over 5 or 10 minutes, yeah, people just shoot at each other. The fact there's only so much ammunition there doesn't matter. But suppose I get hundreds and hundreds of Panzerblitz counters, and we are going to fight two Army Corps attacking each other, an engagement that will last a day or two. Suddenly, all that ammunition consumption, the fact we are ignoring ammunition consumption, leads to the syndrome known as over the top with Gauss rifles. Gauss rifle being a mythical weapon that you can shoot at anything and it will have some likelihood of wrecking it. And if after you're done shooting at it, there's a second button on the rear labeled reload, and you press the reload button, and now it just automatically reloads without having to wonder where the reloads came from. Design for effect is fine, but you have to be careful with it or it will blow up. Now, we could talk about design for accuracy. Oh, that sounds better, doesn't it? There are a couple problems with design for accuracy. The first issue is you can lose track of your audience and the audience doesn't care about the accuracy. The second issue with accuracy is that you have to get everything exactly right or bizarre phenomena will occur. Once upon a time, there was a board war game, the designer fixed this, in which we are conducting an invasion of country A, and the invader units have to be within a certain number of squares of the supply lines, or they are out of supply and awful things happen to them. The supply lines were maintained by rebuilding railroads. And so there were a certain very small number of railroad repair units which could advance one square per turn, rebuilding the railroad. Now the problem with this is that I have just told you, since I must stay within a certain number of squares of the rebuilt railroads, and the railroads rebuild at one square per turn, my advance is going to be one square per turn after a bit. And if the victory city I have to take is 25 squares out, and the farthest in I can move my units without losing them is 20 squares, for sure I'm not going to take it. And this one rule, which looks more decorative, yeah, it's kind of useful, but it doesn't look that critical, because of all of the things I didn't put in, like using trucks to move supplies to the front, building up supply depots and leapfrogging supply depots, because I've skipped some rules that I should have remembered. Game isn't real accurate. Now there is a last problem with accuracy. And the last problem with accuracy is the quality of the historical data. Now, I will give two examples. Some of you may have read the descriptions of World War I, the British and French attacking the Germans during the war. And the picture you may be given is massively incompetent generalship and a horrible waste of life. Does this sound familiar to people? Wave if it sounds familiar. Yes? There is a wonderful book by Mearsheimer, Liddell, Hart, and the Weight of History. And Mearsheimer's point, through doing a detailed analysis, is that the description you have just heard of World War I is a historical fraud. And in fact, the British and French generals were very competent, or at least as competent as they could be, and did have, ditto the German generals, and did have reasonable estimates of what they could do. They were resource limited, but indeed, if you pay attention, you notice that in 1917, the Germans started smashing the Russian army using Stoßtaktik, and in 1918, the Allies introduced tanks, which were actually quite effective, and suddenly, people started winning. Another example of this, you will see claims that the German generals procured the blitzkrieg tactics from reading several books by English generals. And there is even a translation of Guderian's book where he says in so many words, I procured this idea from reading the work of, and he names some English generals. There's one problem with that. If you go to the original German language book, that sentence isn't there. The translator, who was attempting to build up his own reputation as a great military thinker, inserted the sentence and seriously altered our understanding of World War II. The second example I will take of historical accuracy is the question of, well, why did firearms replace bows and arrows? And the usual statement is, well, it takes years and years, decades of practice to train an archer, but you can train someone how to use a firearm rather quickly. Now, you should remember, the firearms in question are matchlocks. So I am standing here with my matchlock, and I have to load the weapon with gunpowder. Well, there is this burning thing sitting here. And so what I have to do is hold the burning thing over here and load it one-handed. And you have to be extremely skillful to do this, and under battlefield conditions, which are quite terrifying because there are people 20 yards that way shooting at me, it's even more terrifying. Training good musketeers was very challenging. Training archers, well, there were debates in period as to how long it took to train an archer. And the in period sources, and I thank for this to Melissa Scott, science fiction writer, Dr. Scott, military history, the in-period people thought you could train archers faster than you could train musketeers. The notion it takes years and decades of practice is due to the English historian C.V. Oman, a good Whig historian of the Victorian period. The simplest refutation of his claim, let's think for a question, moment. It's a muscle skill, it's like playing basketball, right? How many basketball players and champion basketball players can you think of who were in their 40s and 50s? There were a few baseball players. Baseball is less physically strenuous. No, the description of why bow was replaced is not well known. Okay, I am running out of time, so therefore next time I am going to discuss quality, what might make things a good game. And I'm going to point out that quality is determined by audience because you are serving several audiences and they have opposite opinions on the topic. And that's actually rather serious. And then I'm going to not come to the word fun. And I am not going to come to it for one reason. I collect board wargaming magazines. I have 16 four-drawer filing cabinets full of them. I have never encountered a game reviewer who talks about the variable fun, at least using that word. I'm not saying there aren't any, but I have never run into one. This is somewhat the opposite of computer gaming, where there are whole books on theory of fun. In any event, I have abused the time limit, so we are done. Class is dismissed.